Okay, a little slow this morning, but I'll take that. It's great to be here again at TechEd Australia. This is my sixth year presenting here, and I just love Australia and the Gold Coast, and such a fantastic venue to be talking about exchange. In fact, for those of you who were here last year, who was here last year? And who attended the Exchange 2013 sessions? All right, so last year at TechEd Australia, we actually debuted the Exchange 2013 content. So this venue in particular is special because you got content before anyone else. And that is true for some of the sessions that we're doing this week. Later on today, I'll be doing a sizing session. That's the first time that we've really done that full session publicly. There's also a high availability session, which will be different from what we've done last year and also different from what I did in North America and Europe. So it's a brand new presentation later on. And then, of course, the tips and tricks session at the end of the week is always new as well. But here, now we're here to talk about upgrading and coexistence with Exchange 2013. So how many of you are running 2013 today? All right, so if you're running 2013 today, you've already upgraded, and so a lot of what we're going to talk about won't apply to you. So how many of you are running 2010? Fantastic. And 2007? All right, not as much, but still plenty. Any 2003 in the room? All right, wow, quite a few hands. So we're actually not going to be covering the 2003 migration, but if you do have any questions, feel free to ask them as we go along, or of course ask them at the office showcase experience or at the Ask the Experts as well. So let's go ahead and get started. This session is really just designed to help those of you who are running Exchange 2007 and Exchange 2010 understand all of the steps that are involved in getting you from the version you're on now to the latest version, which currently is Exchange 2013 RTM with Cumulative Update 2, version 2 of Cumulative Update 2 out there. And we'll talk about how that process goes in a bit. I think you'll find, though, the key takeaway is that particularly those of you who have done an upgrade from 2007 to 2010, you're going to find that the experience is pretty similar, and that the coexistence and upgrade process for both 2007 and 2010 are also very similar. There's just a couple extra nuances, a couple extra things you need to deal with when you're going from 2007 to 2013. So let's start with some of the deployment fundamentals. These are the prerequisites, the system requirements, and so forth, the things that you actually have to have in place before you can deploy 2013 in your organization. So for one thing, for those of you running an existing version of Exchange, it has to be either 2007 or 2010, and it has to be running a specific level of service pack. And in the case of 2007, it also has to be running a specific rollup update at a minimum. And that applies to every single server in your organization, including your edge transport servers. So you will not be able to introduce Exchange 2013 into your environment until all of your existing legacy Exchange servers are brought forward to that version. In terms of the clients, we've really narrowed down our client access methods. I'll talk about this a little bit later, but the most important change is for Outlook clients. Outlook clients are no longer allowed to connect via RPC over TCP. We now only allow Outlook clients to connect using Outlook Anywhere, or what we call RPC over HTTP. In effect, we've taken all of the Outlook clients and turned them into HTTP clients as well. So that means Outlook 2010, Outlook 2013, of course, and Outlook 2007. All of those support Outlook Anywhere, and those are the supported Windows Outlook clients. If you're not using Windows, but you're still using Outlook, Outlook for the Mac 2011 is supported, as is the version of Entourage that supports web services. So we haven't had WebDAV in the product for a couple versions, so if you're going from 2007 to 2013 and you are using WebDAV clients, those will need to be upgraded as well. Now, in terms of Active Directory, there's a very good chance that most of you will not have to touch Active Directory as part of your Exchange upgrade. It may be the case, however, that some of you are still using 32-bit directory servers, and you may want to go ahead and upgrade those to 64-bit directory servers to handle the increased load from your users and the increased load that the directory-enabled applications like Exchange place on the system. But generally, in terms of the forest itself, the forest functional level can stay at Windows Server 2003. degree or higher. There are no benefits to one FFL versus another. It's just the minimum support that we need for Exchange to be able to operate. You need also at least one directory server in every site that's running at least Windows Server 2003, SP2, or later. Okay, that's not a big deal. Hopefully most of you are well beyond that for your directory servers. But if you're not, then your directory servers are probably not running a supported version of Windows at this point because it's so old, so you'll want to upgrade them anyway. Now, in terms of read-only directory servers, Exchange and Outlook still both require writable directory servers. We need a writable global catalog for both Outlook and Exchange. And although read-only directory servers can exist in an Exchange environment, Exchange and Outlook simply ignore them and will not use them. So you still have to have writable GCs in every site into which you deploy an Exchange mailbox or an Exchange user. Now let's talk about namespaces. How many of you are not running with what we would consider to be a contiguous or standard namespace? Anybody with a disjointed or single label domain or any kind of strange namespaces? I don't think I see a single hand going up. Oh, maybe one or two. Oh, some waving over there. Okay, a couple of you. So the good news is, for those of you who did raise your hand, we do support all the same namespaces that we supported with 2010 and with 2007. And to a large degree, we support things like a single label domain simply because Windows supports it. And if Windows support goes away for it, there's a pretty good chance that Exchange support for that namespace would also go away from it as well. Now, changing the namespace once Exchange has been introduced into an organization can be kind of a difficult thing to do. So if you are in one of these non-standard namespaces and you do want to get yourself out of it, you want to do those operations prior to introducing Exchange 2013. That will be the best method to go. But again, there's no requirement for you to do that. We do all support these different namespaces. And if you're not familiar with them, by the way, things like a single label domain, that would be a DNS name that doesn't have a top level domain. So for instance, it could match a NetBIOS name. So Microsoft instead of Microsoft.com is an example. Now the operating system, Exchange 2013, can be installed on one of two operating systems, either Windows Server 2008 R2, or with SP1 or later, or Windows Server 2012. And we'll talk about the additions in a moment. You will get a better experience with Windows Server 2012 for a couple reasons. First, the deployment experience is better. It includes prerequisites that Windows 2008 R2 does not. So that's less things you have to download, less things you need to install, and so forth. And of course, it's the latest code with the latest bug fixes, the latest performance enhancements, and the latest features. And there are, in fact, some Windows Server 2012 features that Exchange does support as well. So you will get a better experience with that, but we do still support Windows 2008 R2 with SP1 or later. Now, in terms of the additions, if you're splitting out your server roles, which is generally not recommended for Exchange 2013, as was the case with 2010, we are promoting multi-role, and I'll talk about more of that in the sizing session later this afternoon. But really, we haven't really come up with legitimate reasons to split out the roles, so we are looking at multi-role configurations in Exchange 2013. So multi-role, of course, in 2013 paradigm means simply CAS and mailbox on the same box, since those are the only two roles that we have now. When you do that, if you are planning on having that mailbox server be a member of a database availability group, then you're going to be needing to run the enterprise or data center version of Windows 2008 R2. If, however, you're running Windows 2012, the clustering features are both in standard and data center. There is no enterprise version. And so you can use standard for your mailbox servers and put them in a DAG as well. Okay, so not too much of a difference there. There are other components that you need. There's IIS components, obviously the .NET framework, because a lot of Exchange is a managed code application now. You'll obviously also need the Windows Management framework, so you get the goodness of remote PowerShell. And the Unified Communications Managed API is now required for all server roles as well, as the UM components are split between CAS and Mailbox right now. All of those components, except for UCMA, are included in Windows Server 2012 and would not need to be downloaded separately. UCMA still needs to be downloaded separately, though, so regardless of the OS you're using, you'll still have to go get that separate download. Now, let's talk briefly about the architecture changes. I'm not going to go too deep because, let's face it, we've been out for more than a year now, and one of the things that we've been talking about a lot are the architectural changes that we made. But I do want to highlight, in case you haven't been made aware of it, some of these changes here. So over here on the on your left side, as you're facing it, you'll see the Exchange 2010 architecture, over here, 2013. And you'll notice some significant differences. Obviously, as I mentioned earlier, we're just down to two server roles in Exchange 2013, CAS and Mailbox. So all of the functionality that we have in Exchange 2010 needed to go into one of those roles. Now, basically what we did is we took things like the authentication components, the proxying and redirection components, and we put them into a new client access server. And I say new to emphasize the fact that even though it has the same name as the server role in 2010 and 2007, it's very different. The CAS in 2013 is simply a lightweight protocol proxy. It's very different from what we had as a middle-tier server role in Exchange 2010. And in fact, the Exchange 2010 CAS role now exists as the CAS service inside the mailbox role. So authentication, proxying, and redirection went to CAS. All the rest of that went to mailbox. So that would be the protocol stacks themselves, not the proxies, they're in CAS, but the actual protocol stacks themselves, they're in mailbox, along with the all the API support, like web services and so forth, all of the business logic, all of the PowerShell objects, everything exists on mailbox. CAS, in fact, without mailbox is completely useless. You can't even connect to it because it's mailbox that provides the remote PowerShell endpoint. And then, of course, the information store is still in the mailbox, as is our new content indexing engine that we call Search Foundation, the same search technology that we're using across Exchange and SharePoint. That also includes a federated search API as well. All right, let's talk about upgrade and coexistence. So I'm going to walk you through the process for upgrading to Exchange 2010, or upgrading from 2010, rather, to 2013. And then we'll briefly walk through the process from 2007 to 2013, and then we'll dig into all the steps to find all the details. So what I'm showing you here is a very basic topology here. It's got one internet-facing site and one non-internet-facing site, or what we call an intranet site. And even though you can see we've got 2010 over here and some 2010 over there. In this animation, we are showing you the separate server roles, but ideally, again, you would be using a multi-role environment in Exchange 2010 as well. But whether you're using single server roles or multi-roles, the actual upgrade process is exactly the same. So we've got two namespaces in our 2010 environment, one for AutoDiscover, and the other one is mail.contoso.com. We're using that for our email namespace. And the process that you'll do is very similar to the process that you've gone through if you've done previous Exchange upgrades. So as an example, you need to verify that the environment is ready, and that things like making sure you've got the prerequisites, making sure that you've got the right hardware and so forth, making sure that Active Directory is ready and so forth. So you'll do all that work, you'll validate that everything's good to go, you'll probably take backups of the environment and get your back-off scripts ready and so forth, and then you'll proceed with the actual deployment. Now, you'll deploy both mailbox and CAS. The actual order in which you deploy them does not matter. Again, if you're going multi-role, you'll be deploying them both together. But again, you do need to deploy both. Now, in Exchange 2010 and all earlier versions, we had a very specific order that we wanted you to use for installing the server roles. It was the CHUM order, C for CAS, H for Hub, U for UM, and M for Mailbox. So you followed that order, and that's how you deployed 2010. There's only two server roles, CAS and Mailbox, and you can't connect to Mailbox directly. You have to proxy through CAS, and you can't do anything with CAS without Mailbox, so you have to install them both. The order in which you do that does not matter. You can install CAS first, then Mailbox, Mailbox first, then CAS, install them both together, it does not matter. But until you have both roles deployed, you won't be able to do anything. Next, you're going to be possibly obtaining new certificates if you don't have them or if you're changing your namespaces, and then you'll be deploying your certificates throughout the environment. And this will be both in the new 2013 environment, and there will be certificates that you'll deploy on your legacy servers and perhaps on your reverse proxies if you're terminating SSL there as well. We'll talk a little bit more about certificates and their best practices in a bit. Then you're going to switch the primary namespace, and this is nothing harder than going into DNS and changing where, in this case, mail.contoso.com and autodiscover.contoso.com point to. Right now, they're pointing to, in this case, the load balancer that's in front of the Exchange 2010 environment, but you're going to change that in DNS so that they point now to the load balancer that's in front of the Exchange 2013 environment. And then 2013 as we've always done with Exchange, will now become the front door for all of your users, even those users whose mailboxes still exist on the legacy version. Once you've done that, again, you still want to validate client access, and we've got some wonderful tools, free tools for you to do that. There's a lot of commandlets built into Exchange 2013 that you can use, and there's also the remote connectivity analyzer that you can use as well. So you can just go to www.exrca.com. That will take you to the remote connectivity analyzer, and you can verify that after you made this change, that client access is still working, and everyone can still use that namespace with SSL and go through the 2013 front door to get to a 2010 mailbox at this point. Then the next thing you're going to do is you're going to move your mailboxes. So you're going to start by building out a DAG. Hopefully you're all running database availability groups, or you're planning on doing it. But either way, you've got to stand up some mailbox servers, and whether you're doing a DAG or not, you're going to use the online move mailbox process to move the mailboxes from 2010 to 2013. And as its name implies, we call it online move mailbox because the user remains online and inside their mailbox as their mail's being moved over. There's just a very brief disconnection and reconnect once the move is done, and that is a seamless and transparent action for the user. So you'll move the mailboxes over. Once everybody's moved over, then you can proceed with other things like public folders and the decommission process of the legacy servers. And we'll talk about public folder migrations briefly in a bit as well. And then you would repeat that for additional sites. So here we started with an internet-facing site, and then we only had one other site to do. If you have multiple internet-facing sites, we recommend doing all of those first, and then your non-internet-facing sites after that. We also typically recommend doing just one site at a time. Once you're done with that site, move on to another one, but don't do multiple sites at the same time because it could cause confusion or delays in the upgrade process. All right, so that was the process going from 2010 to 2013. Kind of quick and painless. There's just a few things that the administrator needs to do in terms of their homework, and I'll actually show you a tool that makes it even easier for you to do that along the way in a moment. But now I want to just walk through the process of going from 2007 to 2013, and you'll see it's very, very similar to what we had with 2010 to 2013. So again, we're going to start with the prerequisites and getting those deployed throughout the organization. This is 2007, so that's going to be 2007 SP3 with update rollup 10. And that, again, has to be put on all of your Exchange 2007 servers, including your Edge Transport servers. And also, after you've deployed these updates to the Edge Transport servers, you're also going to need to redo your Edge subscriptions as well. That is how we will get the updated version information for those Edge servers into Active Directory so that when Exchange 2013 setup runs, it knows that those servers have been upgraded or not. So it's not just for the Edge. It's not just enough in getting the updates out there. You have to recreate that Edge subscription too. Then, again, you'll deploy Exchange, both CAS and Mailbox. The order you do that doesn't matter, but just deploy them both, perhaps in, a multi-role location. Then you've got one extra step that you need to do for 2007 that you don't need to do for 2010, and that involves creating what we call a legacy namespace. So in 2010, in that migration, both 2010 and 2013 can share that single namespace. They can both use mail.contoso.com, and both 2013 and 2010 know how to do the right way in terms of where the user's mailbox is. But 2007 does not. 2007 cannot share the namespace with 2013, so it needs its own namespace, and we've just arbitrarily called that a legacy namespace. Now, some customers have taken us quite literally. They've actually created namespaces like legacy.contoso.com. And that's fine. If that's the namespace that you want to use and it's available, go ahead. But there is no hard-coded requirement to have the word legacy as part of that namespace. We just need another FQDN so that when a 2007 user hits the 2013 CAS server, the 2013 CAS server knows what namespace to send them to get their mailbox. And I'll show you what that looks like when we go through the mail flow for the clients in a minute. Now, after you've done that, you are going to have to obtain new certificates because you're creating a new namespace, that legacy namespace, and that legacy namespace has to go on your certificates as well. So everywhere you're going to terminate SSL, on the 2013 servers, on your reverse proxies, on the 2007 servers, you have to get that certificate on there as well. So there could be a charge depending on what certification authority you're using and how you obtain your certificates, but you will need new ones that include the legacy namespace that you've introduced. Once you finish deploying them, then the next thing is, again, switching that namespace. So you go into DNS, you change the DNS records, and once the clients pick that up, they'll go ahead and start moving over connectivity to the Exchange 2013 site. So generally speaking, it's kind of a good idea to have a low DNS TTL a few days before you're about to do that migration. That way the clients will just pick up that change right away, and you don't have to worry too much about any laggards or people not picking up the change right away. And then, as was the case before, you would build out a DAG and do your online move mailbox. And it is also an online mailbox move coming from 2007 as well. So there's very little user interruption that will take place as part of this migration. All right, repeat for additional sites when you're done. Okay, so let's dig into some of these steps a little bit deeper and see what's involved in that. So let's start with the prep. So remember, in every Active Directory site, that should actually say in each Active Directory site, not in each Active Directory, but in each AD site in which you're deploying Exchange, you have to have a Windows Server 2003 SP2 or later Global Catalog Server. Again, that should not be a problem for all of you because that is our minimum level supported of Windows Server at this time. You also need at least one writable DC, and we typically recommend that you make that a GC as well. As I mentioned earlier, your forced functional level typically will not need to change. It can stay at Windows 2003 FFL, or you can raise it. That won't matter from an Exchange perspective. So if you do need to change it for another directory-enabled application, feel free to do that. That will not affect Exchange at all. Now, in terms of the Outlook requirements, we do have, obviously, specific versions that are required, but we also have some very strongly recommended updates as well. Just calling one out in particular, that last update for the August 2013 update that we have for Outlook 2007. That actually fixes a pretty bad bug in Outlook, where Outlook is confusing the internal and external settings as well. So that is something that, even though it's not required to deploy Exchange, it's an update that we strongly recommend you deploy. And typically, regardless of what Outlook client you are using, we always recommend that you run with our latest updates as well. So keep that in mind. Now, I mentioned that RPC over HTTP is the only protocol that we allow. Some folks have mistakenly interpreted that to mean that we're not using MAPI anymore. That is not the case. It's RPC MAPI encapsulated in HTTP. So absolutely, MAPI is still in there, and we're still using it as the communication protocol between Outlook and Exchange. It's just wrapped up in nice HTTP packets that are firewall-friendly and can go through without a VPN. Now, WebDAV clients, though, they will need to be upgraded. There's no way to use WebDAV because that protocol simply doesn't exist in 2013 anymore. So if you do have a WebDAV client, they absolutely need to be upgraded before you deploy 2013 because they will not work and will not connect to 2013. Now, we talked about all of these prereqs. Again, I just want to give you the point one more time that with Windows Server 2012, all of these prereqs are built in. The only thing that you need to go get is that UCMA API. And again, you're just deploying that on your servers, whether you're using unified messaging or not. We need that as a prereq for installing Exchange. But if you're on Windows Server 2012, everything in here but UCMA comes in the box, and it makes it so much easier, and it's such a time saver to do the deployment, particularly scripted deployments where you're used to having to install prerequisites, maybe silently and suppressing reboots and whatnot. Now you don't need to do all of that work. You can just have Exchange actually install the Windows prereqs that it needs out of the box. Now, you do have to get all those legacy updates. When setup for Exchange 2013 runs, it will actually interrogate Active Directory, and it will look at the version information for all of your servers. And if it finds any server that does not meet the minimum requirements for introducing 2013, it will block setup with an error. Errors in setup are things you cannot get past. Warnings you can get past, but errors you cannot. So this is a hard blocker. And as I mentioned with the Edge subscriptions, it's not just enough to install the update. You have to recreate the Edge subscription so that the internal Active Directory can pick up the version info changes. Once you're ready to do that, you're ready to prepare Active Directory as well. Now, the choice of how you prepare Active Directory is up to you. You can use these command switches that you see up here, and you can certainly do the prep steps one at a time if you'd like to do that. Or you can skip them completely and just allow the first Exchange 2013 install you do to go ahead and do this work for you. It really depends on how large your Active Directory environment is, how much control you want over the schema changes and the replication of those changes, and what other security or deployment considerations you have to take into place in your company. So you have a choice. You can do it separately. You've always been able to do it separately, or you can simply just let the first server do it. If you do it separately, though, you do have to do it in a specific order. So that means using PS or prepare schema to prepare the Active Directory schema. And that basically involves us making changes vis-a-vis the introduction of new classes and attributes in Active Directory. Then you need to prepare the organization, which gives us the Exchange System Objects container. Then you need to prepare the domains, and that could be maybe all domains at once, or it could be just a local domain, or it could be specific domains one at a time. However you want to do it, it's up to you. But you do need to take all of those steps, because if you skip any one out of order, you're going to have to go back and restart. And of course, if you decide to skip all the steps, as I mentioned, the first Exchange server that you install is going to do all these things anyway, so keep that in mind. All right, so the next step is doing the actual deployment process. And setup has changed a little bit. So historically, with 2010 and 2007, we had two setup executables, setup.exe, which would run the GUI version, and setup.com, which would run the command line version. Now there's just setup.exe. There's just one version. And if you run setup.exe by itself, it runs the GUI version. If you add some command line switches to it, it runs the command line version. Now, one of the things I want to point out, you can see this example command line down at the bottom. We have this new switch. And it's a very long switch. It's the slash I accept Exchange Server license terms. If you are doing a command line setup, you have to include this switch on every setup operation that you run. So that could be a command line setup of a fresh install. It could be a command line setup doing an upgrade to a cumulative update. It could be a command line setup doing a recover server operation. Either way, you have to include that with everyone to explicitly accept the license agreement. And this was a change that was actually introduced by our lawyers, because in Exchange 2010 and 2007, if you look at the way setup runs, it is actually a passive agreement of the license agreement. You run setup, and if you don't do anything, that means you accept the license agreement and setup will continue. If you don't accept the license agreement, you hit a key and setup terminates because you said you didn't agree to it. Well, that passive acceptance of a license could be non-enforceable in some jurisdictions. So we have to have customers actively accept our license terms. So we do that now, obviously in the GUI, you can see, or it's actually not on that screen, but there is a check mark where you have to do that in the GUI, as we've always had. But now in the command line, we now force you to do this long I accept Exchange Server license term switches. It doesn't have to be initial case like I show there. I'm just showing it like that. If you want to, you know, do it in all uppercase because you're shouting because you hate that you have to type that, that's fine. You can do that. And regrettably, there is no tab complete, so you do have to type it out every time. So keep that in mind. It's all another reason to go with the scripted process. So again, you're going to be installing Mailbox and CAS. CAS is proxy only. Mailbox has all the objects, including the PowerShell endpoints. You'll always use the latest cumulative update package, so no more installing RTM and then applying a service pack or anything like that. You just go and get the latest version, which again is Exchange 2013 RTM CU2, and you just deploy that, and that gives you a fresh server right out of the gate. And I mentioned the new command line parameters. So here you can see this is what the GUI server role selection. You can see it just has mailbox and client access and management tools there. Those are the only three options that you get. And management tools does get installed by default on every CAS and mailbox that you deploy. But if you just want a management workstation, you actually don't even need to do a management tools install. You can simply use a web browser to get to the Exchange Admin Center, which is the new web-based management UI we have, or you can use remote PowerShell to get to your PowerShell scripting. So if you don't want to install the management tools, you don't have to. You do get the toolbox, though, if you do install them, which is a benefit. And then under there is that other checkbox that says automatically install Windows Server roles features that Exchange needs in order to operate. And that, again, is a great way to have Exchange automatically install the on-box prerequisites that it needs. And Exchange is smart enough so that if installing those Windows prereqs needs a reboot, you can reboot it, and Exchange will leave a watermark in the registry so it can pick up right from where you left off and you don't have to start the process again. So it's a very intelligent process, and I typically always have Exchange do the Windows install components for me. The reason for that is every once in a while, the requirements will slightly change. So for example, when we went from RTM to CU1, we did include a new clustering component that we were installing by default in CU1 that we were not installing by default in RTM. So for that reason, I always use the Windows switch to let it install those. So if those requirements do change, the new setup program knows about it and can get whatever new requirements there are. There is a command line switch I'm not showing up here. It's just slash install Windows components. And if you use that, that's the same as the checkbox in the GUI. All right, so next you'll create a legacy namespace. And again, that's just going into DNS and creating an FQDN that points to the IP address of the load balancer or the appliance that is in front of your Exchange 2007 environment. And that way, Exchange 2013 now has a namespace and an IP address that it can redirect Exchange 2007 mailbox users to until they've been migrated. Next thing would be the certificates again. And the certificates, that experience has been significantly improved in Exchange 2013. I know in Exchange 2007, it was a huge pain to deal with certificates. Things got a little bit better in 2010. Things got much, much better in 2013. So, for instance, inside the new Exchange Admin Center, we now have this, what we call this end-to-end certificate wizard. And the wizard not only allows me to do things that you'd expect, like generating the request and then importing the certificate file and assigning services to it, but it also lets me take certificates that I've gotten and deploy them, including the private key, on all of my CAS servers at once. So I don't have to actually travel from CAS to CAS to CAS to deploy it. I can just use one wizard inside the EAC and have it send that certificate and get it installed and configured on all the CAS servers in my organization. So that's very fast. Now, EAC, the Exchange Admin Center, also provides you with these new notifications as well. So when a certificate is about to expire, we now notify the administrator right inside the UI. And what we'll do is we give them one notification when they're 30 days away from the expiration. If they don't renew it within that 30 days, then during that 30-day countdown period, we alert them every single day. Your cert's about to expire. Your cert's about to expire. Because if that cert expires, that could sever client connectivity. So the administrator really needs to be on top of it. And it sounds like an easy thing to do, but I cannot tell you the number of times we have had some internal infrastructure or some service break inside of Microsoft because somebody forgot to renew the certificate. So it's an easy thing to overlook and forget, but if you don't do it, it breaks everything. So now we want to put these alerts right in the admin's face every time they log on, every time they're in the tool, and let them know they've got a critical thing that they need to take care of. Now, we do have best practices for certificates, and they are in large part identical to the best practices we had for Exchange 2010. Obviously, certificates cost money, and for some certificates, the more names that you put on them, the more money it costs. So we want to minimize complexity, we want to minimize cost, and so we want to minimize the number of names that you're going to be using on the certificates. So the good news is you don't need a whole lot of names. You know, for example, there's really no legitimate reason to put any of the server names inside the certificate. So you can already forget about that. So if you've got a lot of servers and you're worried how they're all going to fit, don't worry about that. All you really need are things like the auto-discover namespace, a primary namespace, or multiple primary namespaces if you're not using split DNS or if you're not using a single namespace. And then if you're coming from 2007, that legacy namespace. That's really all that you need. Now, you may be running other workloads. You might be running Link, for example, or SharePoint, for example. Some of those other workloads may have, and do have, for example, different requirements from Exchange. So Link needs a certificate that has greater than or equal to 1024 bits. Exchange does not. So if you are using what some vendors are now calling a UC certificate, which, by the way, is not a real thing. It's just a made-up name. But if you are using one of those things, you may have to buy a certificate that is a bit more expensive because Link or the other workload has more requirements than Exchange does. But if you just need the cert for Exchange, you can go simple and cheap. A general recommendation is to use split DNS that is using the same exact name, internal and external, with just different IP addresses for your internal and external endpoints. If you can't do that, and not all customers can, or maybe they're too large and they want to use multiple namespaces for a reason, that's fine. You can include all of those on the certificate. And we strongly recommend that you use a subject alternative name certificate as well. There's basically two types of certs that will support multiple names. One's a wildcard certificate, the other is a SAN certificate. We support wildcard certificates, but we don't recommend them because of the security implications. A wildcard certificate would be a cert like star.microsoft.com. We will never issue that certificate because if that certificate got lost or stolen, anybody could spoof any hostname at microsoft.com and the client will not complain at all. Okay, so we would never want that to happen. So we always use SAN certs. But we do support both kinds if you do need a wildcard cert. One other thing I'll also point out is in CU2, there was an important fix. There was a bug in the certificate wizard where the O and the OU fields were getting flipped around. And so when you did the certificate request, they were actually backwards from the CA's perspective. And you had to go in and manually edit that and generate a new request to fix it. CU2 fixes that, so you don't have to do that anymore. And again, you're back to a very smooth and seamless certificate experience. All right, the next thing is to switch that primary namespace. So I did talk about it being as simple as a DNS change, but obviously there's load balancing that's involved as well. From a load balancing perspective, things have gotten a little bit better in Exchange 2013 in regards to the fact that you have more options available to you right now. So in Exchange 2010, we really required you to have a load balancer that supported application level session affinity, or what is sometimes called layer 7 load balancing. So we don't need application level session affinity anymore because of the architecture changes that we made. There is no session on CAS anymore. CAS is just a protocol proxy. The actual protocol stack, along with the mailbox, exists on the mailbox server now. And the active mailbox is always served by that local protocol stack that's on the same mailbox, which means the application session is all on one machine already, and so we don't need to have that affinity at the load balancer layer anymore. So now we can use affinity-less, or TCP affinity, if you will, or what sometimes is called a layer 4 load balancer. Okay, so a layer 4 load balancer is a very simple, basic load balancer. And although it's supported, if you're in a large, complex environment and you want things like per protocol availability, where you have separate availability for, say, the ActiveSync protocol versus Outlook Web App versus Outlook Anywhere and so forth, then you may actually still continue to use a layer 7 load balancer because they will have those sophisticated features that will allow you to get that per protocol availability. But layer 7 or layer 4 both are both supported. If you're using layer 4 on 2013, you still need to use layer 7 on 2010 and 2007. So you will have some load balancing to configure. Then you'll create the legacy namespace in DNS, both internal and external. Internally, you can use ping or NS lookup to verify it, and externally, you can use the remote connectivity analyzer. Now, this has testconnectivity.microsoft.com. That is one of many URLs that will take you to that site. You can also use the shorter one, which is exrca.com or aka.ms/exrca. Lots of different URLs will take you there. But you do definitely want to validate that that legacy namespace is working properly before you start moving people's mailboxes over. Because once you start that process, there's going to be 2007 users who haven't been moved, and they will require that legacy namespace in order to get access to their mailbox through the 2013 server. And then, of course, the next thing that you do after you make the DNS changes is you need to configure Outlook Anywhere. And that could be a good preparatory step for you even before you begin the process. You may actually want to take the time to take all of your internal Outlook clients and configure them to start using Outlook Anywhere today against your existing infrastructure. It won't really change anything from a bandwidth or administration or a client experience perspective, but it will set the stage for allowing your clients to seamlessly connect up to 2013 once you introduce that CAS server. Now, one of the other things that we did in CU2 is we brought back what we call that silent redirection with single sign-on. And in fact, we usually call it silent redirection with silent single sign-on, because we've found that the use of the term single sign-on can actually mean different things in different places. So for instance, if you think about single sign-on in Office 365, that means you use the same username and password everywhere. That doesn't mean that it's going to automatically pass those credentials for you. In Exchange, when we say silent single sign-on, we mean just that. The underlying client will pass those credentials for you, or the CAS server will move them over and send them to another CAS server for you. So you don't have to enter them again. So that's why we call it a silent single sign-on. So if you're a 2013 to 2007 in the same or different site, or 2013 to 2010 in the same or different site, we will now silently redirect to the appropriate namespace or to the appropriate legacy server, and silently pass the credentials in the background and just take the user right into their mailbox. Again, this is in CU2 only. In RTM and CU1, the user will have to enter their username and password in there. All right, so now that we've talked about the upgrade process and a couple of the nuances, let's look at the actual client connectivity flow. And it's typically easiest to demonstrate just using an Outlook web app client, because that's simple HTTP. But again, if you start thinking about it, almost all our clients are HTTP now. ActiveSync, Web Services, PowerShell, OWA, and now, of course, Outlook. All HTTP clients. So they're all going to pretty much behave largely the same, with some exceptions. And I've got a chart in the next couple slides that will show you some of these exceptions. So what I have here is I've got my 2010 infrastructure and my new 2013 infrastructure. Again, I've separated the server roles in this diagram for illustration purposes. In a real production environment, these would be multi-roles, and you wouldn't have CAS and mailbox separate, but I just wanted to isolate them so you could understand more clearly the kind of flow that we're doing. So we've got our client up at the top. The client is using a single namespace for both versions of Exchange, mail.contoso.com. So that client will resolve that in DNS, and DNS will resolve that endpoint to the IP address on that load balancer. The load balancer will then pass that over to IIS on the 2013 CAS, any 2013 CAS in the CAS array behind that load balancer. The 2013 CAS will then do two lookups. It will look up an Active Directory, first to authenticate the user, and then to find out what version of mailbox they're running on. And if the user is running on Exchange 2010 or 2013, then the CAS will do a second lookup in Active Manager to find out where that user's mailbox is located. Because CAS only has one goal in mind for this user, and that is to proxy the connection to the mailbox server that hosts the active copy of the mailbox. So in this case, IIS does the lookups, and it recognizes, you can see the people over there, that this is a 2010 mailbox. So it will go ahead and send that over to the 2010, and then the 2010 server will talk RPC to the store. So when we're talking RPC to the store, and it's a multi-role server, that's local RPC, that is not network RPC, so it's a very snappy type of conversation here. All right, and that's just a very basic type of proxy situation where the 2013 server is just proxying the communication over to the 2010 CAS server, and then the 2010 CAS server talks RPC to the mailbox, gets the information back, sends it back through the proxy, and up to the client. Very, very simple and straightforward. Now let's add in another site. So obviously our first site, this one right here, that's internet-facing because it's got the load balancer and the namespace. Now let's add a site that is non-internet-facing. This is just an intranet-only site, so all communications coming from the internet will actually go through the internet-facing site. So again, same process, the same OWA client does the lookup, resolves to the load balancer, the traffic gets passed through, IIS does the lookup, it finds out that the user's mailbox is now over here on this server, and it will go ahead and proxy that request over to the 2010 CAS, and just as we did before, the 2010 CAS will talk RPC to the mailbox server. That's what we call a cross-site proxy request. We are proxying the HTTP request across the Active Directory site to get to where that user's mailbox is currently active. Now let's mix things up a bit. Now let's pretend that this site is now an internet-facing site. So things get a little different here because we now have a second namespace and a second point of ingress into the system. So the OWA client will, again, resolve that name. It'll go through the load balancer. IIS will do the lookup. It will find out not only that the mailbox is in this other site, but it will also look up the external URL value and find out that that's an internet-facing site. And because it's an internet-facing site, we're going to kick that request back, and we're going to send it up to the client, and we're going to redirect the client over to that internet-facing site. And so we will silently redirect in CU2 and later. In RTM and CU1, the experience is not as good, but in CU2 and later, which is what you all should be running, there will be a silent redirection. And then after that, a silent single sign-on as well. So the user will just go right into their mailbox, not having any awareness of the legacy or of the fact that they're being redirected or that they're now talking to a different CAS server or a different load balancer and so forth. All right, and then, of course, we're going to talk RPC to the store again. Now, let's look at how the 2007 experience is. It's a little bit different. So here we've got one internet-facing site. They're both in the same site, but we've got two namespaces because we have to have that legacy namespace in front of the 2007 CAS servers. So the OWA client will come in, it'll go through the load balancer, it will get authenticated by IIS. IIS will do the lookup, find that the mailbox is on the 2007 server, and in this case, we'll kick it back because there's a namespace, and we will silently redirect it in this same site, in this case, over to that namespace, and then if you're running CU2, silently sign the user on again by passing their credentials through forms-based authentication, and then the user's in their mailbox, and CAS will talk RPC to the store again. Pretty straightforward stuff. But now let's make it more complicated. Let's add another site in there. Now, this site that we're adding now is not internet-facing, and so this is kind of an interesting pathway of communication that we go through. Again, we're starting with 2013 being the front door. We hit the load balancer, pass it on to IIS. We do the lookup. We find out that we're in this non-internet-facing site, and this is where things get interesting. We kick the request back, and we do a redirection. But we can't redirect to that non-internet-facing site, so instead, we'll redirect to the legacy site. Okay, and so that legacy CAS server will then authenticate the user silently as we pass through credentials. And then once we're on that CAS server, it's going to go ahead and proxy that all the way across the site to the other CAS server. Now, I want to be clear, this line that you see going, let me redraw it for you. So this line, it's not actually going through the 2013 CAS server. Visually, it looks that way, but that was the only way to get the line from one site to the other. So we are not going through the 2013. This is actually a proxy right from 2007 CAS in this site to the 2007 CAS in that site. Now, let's mix it up one more time. Let's add another namespace over there. So now we've got three namespaces in our 2007 coexistence. So again, come through OWA, hit the load balancer, we'll get authenticated, find out that the mailbox is over there in that other site, but we'll also find out that it's now an internet-facing site because we can see the external URL is europe.mail.quintosar.com. And so we will kick that back to the OWA client and redirect them over to the Europe site. And again, that's going to be a silent redirection in CU2 and a silent single sign-on as well in CU2. Okay? Pretty simple and straightforward flows, but it can get a little bit tricky there, especially when you've got 2007 in an internet-facing site and 2007 in a non-internet-facing site. You'll be proxying between them. There's other communication flows as well, depending on the protocol. Obviously, we just walked through the OWA protocol, but here's some other. This will talk about ActiveSync. This will talk about Outlook Anywhere. This will talk about PowerShell and all the other protocols and all the other behaviors as well. Kind of the only one that really stands out as being a little bit unusual is that Exchange ActiveSync, that 2007 user accessing a 2013 namespace using Exchange ActiveSync. We actually will proxy that through to the 2013 mailbox server. So what that means is you don't want to just turn off all of your legacy mailbox servers until you've actually moved all of your users over there, because there will be a mailbox involved in that proxy scenario. Otherwise, everything is largely what you saw in the previous animations with proxying or redirecting through CAS as appropriate based on the namespace and the configuration. All right. Now, in terms of the switching, let's talk about Outlook Anywhere. You've got to enable Outlook Anywhere for all your clients, and you've got to also enable it on all of your legacy client access servers. So if you're not using Outlook Anywhere today and you're moving to Exchange 2013, you got to start turning it on. You got to get ready for the move. It's got to be on all your legacy servers, and of course, it will need to be on all of your new 2013 CAS servers as well. In terms of IIS authentication, you have to use NTLM on all of your legacy CAS. If you don't, we won't be able to connect. We won't have the security protocol in process, so keep that in mind. You also have to make sure that the legacy Outlook Anywhere settings, so the OA settings on 2007 or 2010, exactly match the settings that you're using in 2013 as well. If they don't match, that could break in some scenarios. And then for a DNS cutover, as I mentioned, because the switch over to the new namespace is really just a DNS change, it's a good idea a few days before that you do the migration that you actually lower the TTL if you haven't done so already. What do we mean by low? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, something less than a day, much less than a day, so that all clients pick that up very quickly. Once you've actually put it at that whatever TTL you choose, you might actually choose to keep it that way as well, depending on things like your high availability topology and any site resilience and other namespace needs that you might have as well. So having a really low TTL is actually not a big deal from an Outlook or Exchange perspective. It might result in your environment in a little bit more DNS traffic as they're refreshing more often, but it's not really that big of a deal from a networking standpoint. All right. So moving mailboxes and building out the DAG. So I'm not going to go into the DAG here, but I do hope that you come to the AHA session where I'll be talking about a lot of stuff that's DAG related. But I do want to talk about the mailbox moves because 2013 does now include this new migration service. So we had the ability to do online move mailboxes in 2010, but now we have the ability to do them in batches with the migration service, and we also have the ability to get reporting, and there's some retry semantics that we included in it as well. So if there are errors that are encountered during the move, the system can actually go through some retry stages on its own without having the admin come in and start the process over again. You can do all of this through the Exchange Admin Center, but we do also have some new commandlets that we've introduced for this functionality as well. But I think you'll find for batch moves, I think it really using EAC is going to be the easiest for most of you. That said, if you've just got so many mailboxes that you just want to start moving in bulk and you've got, you know, quick operations that you need to do, you might find PowerShell a little bit faster. Either way, though, the mail is only going to move so quickly. Okay, and in fact, the rate at which it moves is dependent on more than just the source and target disk and the network that it has to go over. It's also dependent on what's going on the system. Because we have a feature in 2013 called workload management. And workload management is very similar to the user throttling that we had in 2010. In fact, it does a lot of user throttling, but it also does system-wide throttling as well based on available resources. So even if you try to just jam a whole bunch of mailboxes through and just move them as fast as you can, workload management might say, well, there's not really a whole lot of resources available to do the moves, and it could start throttling them back and slowing them down. So keep that in mind as well. And this, by the way, this is what it looks like inside EAC. I know that's small up there, but here you can see the migration batch service that we use. The choices that we have here are migrating to Exchange Online or migrating from Exchange Online. And of course, you can do moves within an Exchange organization as well. This is just showing cloud back and forth. All right, let's talk briefly about public folder mailbox and public folder migration. So I'm not going to get too deep into the detail, but since you may have public folders in your legacy environments, I did want to cover this a little bit. Now, the public folder architecture has changed somewhat in Exchange 2013. So there are no more public folder databases, and there is no more public folder replication. Public folders are now based on the mailbox technology. And actually, we say that's a huge change. It's really actually no change at all, because if you think about what the public folders are in Exchange 2010 or 2007 or every single previous version going back to 4.0, a public folder database is really nothing more than one mailbox inside a database that has some hidden folders and its own replication engine. That's really all the public folders are in legacy versions. So that legacy stuff is gone. Modern public folders are simply folders in a mailbox that you're calling a public folder mailbox that now use log shipping or the continuous replication as their high availability and replication mechanism. So that's a big change. Another big change is you get to control all the public folders in terms of how large you want these mailboxes to grow. And of course, you can have multiple public folder mailboxes, but the content will live in one place and only one place. If you're replicating public folders, you're replicating the same way you would do a mailbox database, where you've got active and passive copies. Same thing with public folders. You will only have one active copy and then X number of passive copies, depending on your replication needs. So what that means is there's also no more multi-master public folders. We don't have content in Europe and content in North America that people can access locally and that somehow magically gets merged together. That doesn't exist anymore. The content exists in one place and in one place only. Migration for public folders is what we call a cutover process. Okay, it's not like the move mailbox where you can just do them at your leisure. You actually have to close and lock the old legacy public folders and then move some data over and unlock and open up the new modern public folders. That's largely how it goes. So let me walk you through that, what that looks like. So over here in the green, we've got our legacy public folders, and over here in the blue, we've got our modern public folders. And so the way it works is, obviously, you're going to be doing all of the prereq stuff. And once you've done that, then we've got some tools. And the first thing you want to do is maybe take a snapshot of your public folders as they exist. Then you're going to run some scripts that we include with Exchange that will examine your public folder, your entire tree and all the contents of it, and create what we call a mapping file. And this mapping file will be a mapping from the legacy public folders to one or more public folder mailboxes. So that's how we will move the data over. The process is pretty straightforward. Once you've got that mapping stuff done, then you'll actually go ahead and create new public folder mailboxes. But you'll put on this hold for migration switch. And you do that to basically signify that you're creating new hidden public folder mailboxes because you're still using the legacy public folder mailboxes. Before you can actually do the migration, you actually have to take all of your clients and move them to 2013. Because new clients can access legacy public folders, but legacy clients cannot access modern public folders. So all of your mailboxes need to be moved first. After the mailboxes have been moved, then you can begin the actual data migration process. And the way it works is it's actually migrating asynchronously in the background. And it'll get to about 90-95% done, and then it'll hold. The migration will be on hold, waiting for the administrator to basically push the button and continue it on. When the administrator's done moving all the mailboxes, it's at that point that they can go ahead and push the button and start the migration process. And the migration process after that is copy the remaining data over, lock the public folders, and then unlock and start displaying the new modern public folders. So it is a cutover migration. And again, all your clients are going to be logged off when this happens. No one's going to be using the legacy public folders. Once everything has been moved over and they're now unlocked, then the clients can come on and they can start using public folders again. From an Outlook perspective, the client experience does not really change at all. From an Outlook web app experience, the client experience changes considerably. The clients have to go and right-click the folders and add them one at a time into the tree, into the favorites tree inside of Outlook Web App. So yes, public folders are available in Outlook Web App, but it is somewhat limited in terms of its support, and it's somewhat limited in terms of the experience when you compare it with an Outlook client. All right. Now, Exchange Web Services clients. So we talked about new clients and modern clients being able to access legacy public folders. Well, there's one exception to that. It's our web services clients. So if you're using Entourage or Outlook for the Mac and you're using web services, the web service clients will not be able to access legacy public folders. They will only be able to access modern public folders. So as soon as you introduce Exchange 2013 and you start moving everybody over, you are going to have potentially EWS clients that now are locked out of getting into public folders. Or you may have applications that are using EWS-based scripts that are now blocked from access there as well. So you're going to want to have a plan from the get-go to make sure that after the mailboxes are moved over, that you move over the public folders as quickly as possible to regain client access for these clients. All right. All right, let's talk a little bit about transport migration, because that's actually a lot easier than it sounds like, because from a transport perspective, all of the same components are there. Now, there is no Exchange 2013 Edge transport server, but you can use a 2007 SP3 RU10 transport server, or you can use an Exchange 2010 SP3 Edge transport server as well. The choice is yours. Of course, you can use third-party SMTP gateways in your perimeter network if you want, but if you do like using Edge or you're using Edge today, you can continue using Edge and it will continue receiving mail, it will continue participating in Edge subscriptions and basically functioning the way you would expect Edge to function today. Now, in terms of mail flow, again, 2013 can accept mail flow just like it can accept the client connectivity, but we typically don't like you to switch over mail flow until about 50% of the clients have their mailboxes moved over. At that point, we think that's a pretty good time to go ahead and transfer mail over as well. So you don't necessarily need to interrupt all of your transport stuff as you're moving mailboxes and getting your clients over to the new experience. You can sort of deal with transport in the middle or towards the end or almost at your leisure, because everything in terms of mail flow and the way we process things will still go the same. Now, that having been said, if you are using some of the new Exchange 2013 transport features, for example, data loss prevention, obviously you will have to have your messages go through a 2013 mailbox server. That's where the transport stack lives, and that's where we'd be able to do things like DLP enforcement and other transport rules and other compliance and other things and so forth. So there may be a reason that forces you to move transport over more quickly, but either way, don't feel like there's pressure for you to move it immediately like there is with moving the mailboxes. All right, just a few miscellaneous things. How many of you are publishing Exchange to the internet using a TMG or UAG? All right, and how many of you are confused or concerned about what to do now that we've done things like stop selling TMG and so forth? Okay, all right, so let's talk about this. So TMG is end of life. You can't buy it anymore. But how many of you own TMG today? All right, great. So if you own TMG today, continue using it. It's still supported. We don't sell it anymore, but it's still going to work. It's still supported. It'd be kind of similar if your car dealer stopped selling the car you bought. That doesn't mean you stop driving that car. You can still use that car. They just don't sell it anymore. It's kind of like that. So yeah, we don't sell anymore. You can take existing servers and still publish them through TMG. You have to make some manual adjustments because the wizards don't know anything about 2013, but you can do it. But from a long-term strategic approach, it's really UAG is our long-term solution that would be designed for publishing Exchange and other workloads. But of course, the other thing is you need to really consider for yourself whether or not you need that sort of functionality. Do you need reverse proxying capabilities? A lot of organizations just actually deployed it because a lot of people were doing it and they thought it was required for all the deployments, and so people would do it. It's not. We've actually never had any requirement in Exchange for reverse proxy technologies. Some folks have done it from a security perspective, and yeah, maybe back in the Windows 2000 days, it was useful when we had less secure operating systems and less secure applications, but that was a long time ago, and we've got very secure applications, we've got very secure hardware, we've got very secure networks, we're secure in deployment, we're secure by default. You could almost just open up 443, have it go through a load-balanced firewall appliance, and go right into your CAS array. That's a pretty safe and secure thing to do. It's what we do. Choice is yours. So continue to use it if you already have it, or use a third-party solution if you prefer that. But whatever you want to do, is I would read that blog post before you get all worried and concerned about the fact that it's going away or what the security implications might be or how you're going to publish things from now on. So check out that blog entry that was written by one of our principal PMs. He really kind of lays out very good arguments as to why this is not as big of a deal as some folks have thought it was. All right. Managing coexistence. Obviously, if you're in an upgrade and coexistence scenario, that means you've got Exchange 2013 coexisting with 2010 or 2007. Well, this is pretty simple, but I do want to mention it for consistency, and that is just use the 2013 tools to manage the 2013 environment. You can also view some 2007 and 2010 stuff with some limited visibility. But if you're going to manipulate 2007 or 2010 objects, use the Exchange Management Console or the version of PowerShell that came with those versions of Exchange, and basically use the separate tools to manage them separately. Obviously, once everyone's on 2013, then you will abandon the legacy tools and just use nothing but EAC and remote PowerShell. And the last thing I want to mention is the quota calculations. We have changed the way that we both calculate and display mailbox quota information. I'll tell you the way the PM for this described it. In Exchange 2010, when we gave you the quota information for a mailbox, we were actually only giving you the tip of the actual iceberg. Okay, there was a whole bunch of other stuff. There's a whole lot of tables and columns and metadata and blobs and all these things that are in a user's mailbox that would be that bottom of the iceberg that was never reflected in the quota. All we were using is the data that the user generated, what was in their folders, what was in deleted items and so forth, and boom, that was your quota. Okay, so now we're actually calculating the actual disk on space on disk that is consumed by the mailbox. We will give you that actual value. So what that means is now when you get the quota values for a mailbox coming from 2007 and 2010 and going to 2013, you'll see these numbers increase dramatically, anywhere from like 30 to 35%. That does not mean that your database got larger or that your disk got smaller. We're just giving you the actual real number. Okay, so it would have been the same number you would have gotten in 2010 had we calculated it correctly. But we're just giving you that real number now. We went back and changed it, and we decided that's silly just to give you the tip when there's all this other stuff that's taking up space. So now we give it to you all. And so when you see these new mailbox sizes being reported against quota, that doesn't mean there's a whole bunch of new data in there or that something's blowing up or something's corrupt. We're actually just giving you the real and correct number now. All right. So just to recap, we do need some updates for coexistence. They have to be deployed everywhere. The actual deployment process for 2010 and 2007 for going to 2013 is largely identical, except for 2007 needing that legacy namespace, which is kind of a bummer. It means some changes of DNS and some new certificates, but it does allow you to get that single sign-on and silent redirection and so forth. Public folders have changed, and that migration has to be done in a very specific way. And TMG UAG, that may change for you in terms of the type of publishing that you're doing for Exchange on the internet. And the last thing I wanted to talk about, since we have a few more minutes, is this wonderful tool called the Exchange Deployment Assistant. How many of you have heard of this tool? All right. It's the tool I'm going to show you is the 2013 version, but we actually introduced this tool back in Exchange 2007. And give me 1 minute just here real quick. I just want to go into here and let everyone see my file system. Nope, just kidding. Nope, got to install Zoomit there. There we go. All right, so the Exchange Deployment Assistant, this is a website. And you can actually just get here by going to aka.ms/exdeploy, or you can search for exdeploy or the Exchange Deployment Assistant. And you'll get taken to this page, which, as you can see here, has deployment assistance for both 1 and 2, or 2010 and 2013 on it. So I'm going to choose the 2013 one. And the scenarios that we have are very similar to the scenarios we had in 2010. Basically, choose if you're doing on-prem or cloud-only or hybrid, which would be a combination of the two. And you just answer just a couple questions. You can see, let's say I'm upgrading from 2010, and I'll hit next. And I'm putting CAS and mailbox on the same server. Again, multi-role is going to be the way we preferred it. And just to zoom in here and show you this, it's asking me this question, are you planning to install these on the same server or separate servers? So here I'm going to do the same server, and I'll click next. Am I running a disjoint namespace? No, I'm in a standard namespace. I'll click next. And do I have an existing edge transport server? And I'll say yes. And now at this point, I've answered all the questions it needs from me. It's giving me basic information about how to navigate the tool and what to do when you're ready to move forward. So how can I see my answers? How can I change my answers? How can I move through the checklist? How can I print? How can I copy and paste, et cetera, et cetera. But after we click next, now we're actually in the meat of the actual deployment. We're going over the prerequisites here, and once we're done with the prerequisites, here's the system requirements that we need. I can go through all of these. And this is the same exact documentation that's on TechNet, except it's been compiled into this application so that you can just step through it very quickly without having to do all this searching. So now I've got to go and collect required information. I grab all that information, like my domains, the FQDNs I'm using, my auto-discover settings, et cetera, click next, and then I can start the configuration process. And this is a series of topics that give you the step-by-step instructions for doing all these things that we've just been talking about. And it not only walks you through how to do all those things, as you can see here, but it also, down at this bottom here, let me scroll. Also has this section down here called, how do I know this worked? And so after each step, we also give you step-by-step instructions for validating that the step completed successfully. So you know before you go on to the next step whether or not you're ready to proceed. Okay, so it's very, very intuitive. It also gives you the ability to print them out, email them, generate a PDF. So if you're in a disconnected network, since we're using the internet here, you can do that as well. So if you haven't checked out this tool and you want really the fastest way to get deployed, again, on-prem, or if you're deploying Office 365, or if you're going to be in a hybrid configuration, this is the fastest way to get deployed. Okay, so the Exchange Deployment Assistant, aka.ms/exdeploy. All right. So with that, we do have 4 minutes left. I'm happy to take any questions that you might have. We don't have any microphones, so I'll ask you to shout the question, and then I'll try to repeat it. And then if you've got really good questions, I have some Exchange architecture posters that I'm giving out as well, that we're giving out at all the Exchange sessions. So I think you had your hand up first. Yes, sir. Great question. Do you have any tips for the decommissioning process of the legacy servers once the upgrade process is complete? Well, there's a couple things that you want to be aware of. For example, once you remove the last legacy server from that organization, you won't be able to introduce any legacy servers at all. Now, that could, in some scenarios, perhaps impede your ability to go back and restore data from pre-migration. But there are ways around that. You could simply spin up a new org that has the same name and a new server that has the same name. So the things that you want to be aware of is first making sure that you moved all the services over. We didn't talk about all of them. For instance, OAB, there's some nuances around that that you need to be aware of. If you're using the server as an expansion server or journaling or any type of special function, or if there's integrated applications, then you've got a little bit more work to do before you just decommission them. Typically, what I recommend is after you've moved everyone over and after you think you're ready, go ahead and do just a normal orderly shutdown of the servers. Don't uninstall, just leave them there, just have Windows just do a normal shutdown. Exchange is integrated, so it'll be a graceful shutdown. And then wait a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, see if anything breaks, see if anybody complains about anything. Typically, that's long enough time. You generally don't want to wait more than 30 days because you... the SAM account needs to get changed from an AD perspective, and so you want to make sure that Active Directory garbage collection doesn't see it as a dead account and start scavenging it. But otherwise, you know, you can bring it up once every 30 days to get around that. And if you keep it down, if it's been down and completely powered off for a month and no one's complained and nothing's broken, then proceed with the normal uninstall process. And the only things that you may run into in the uninstall process is, obviously, when we do the public folder migration, we don't remove the old public folders, so it's going to ask you to do that. It may find, you know, arbitration or discovery mailboxes around or legacy stuff, system mailboxes that you don't need that you might have to remove. But other than that, you can just do the normal uninstall, and that should remove that server gracefully from the org. Great question. Yes, sir.
If we're doing a big bang migration over a weekend. Is there any way to throttle WLM?
So the question is, if we're doing a big bang migration over the weekend, is there any way to throttle the throttler, WLM?
Yeah.
Yes, there are ways that you could throttle or disable it, but it's really only going to kick in when the system has exceeded what we would consider to be acceptable thresholds from a client experience standpoint. So if you're doing a big bang migration and there aren't any clients, we need clients and the client data. We actually collect the RPC performance counters as part of that evaluation. So if there's no clients on there doing anything, then WLM is gonna say, I've got all the resources I need for these zero clients I'm servicing. And so you shouldn't be able, you know, you shouldn't run into barriers or blockers. Now that having been said, you still may want to adjust it or tweak it if, you know, the server is just really overloaded or you're doing other things to it or you're finding that WLM is slowing things down, in which case you'll see that in the event log, so you'll know right away if that's happening. But otherwise, if, you know, no clients are on it, it shouldn't be much of a concern. Yes, sir. Are there plans for a new Edge server? Yes, we have stated that we do intend to eventually release an Exchange 2013 Edge transport server. When that will be, I don't know. Can't say. But we have stated for actually more than a year now that we do plan to deliver one eventually. Yes. Yes, you. Great question. Any considerations with migrating the unified messaging role? So that migration is actually pretty easy. It's just a question of creating a new dial plan on the 2013 mailbox server, which is where the UM stack lives, and then adding the appropriate servers to that dial plan, and then at that point, swinging everything over through either a DNS change, if you happen to be using telephony equipment that can use FQDNs, or going in and changing the IP addresses if it can't use FQDNs to do that. You may want to quiesce any calls in progress or maybe do it on the evening because there's no real way to take something in progress and have it swing over to another server. So you'll have to wait for no user activity. But otherwise, it's a very easy and straightforward process. The only nuance that changes is we've taken the UM components and we've split them across both roles. So UM clients, they behave slightly different than, say, an HTTP client. A UM client or a SIP caller will actually talk to a UM call router component on the client access server, and then they will get a SIP or an RTP redirection to the mailbox server with the UM stack. And that is really the only exception for all clients connect to CAS. It's the SIP and UM callers that will get redirected and actually talk to the UM service on the mailbox. So that's where your connectivity is going to go now. All right, I think we've got time for one more question. One more, am I missing? Over here, yes.
Just with the load balances.
Yes.
If you're running both roles on your servers, you obviously can't use an LB if you've got a bag.
Mm-hmm. Correct, so it's about load balancers. If you're doing multi-role like we recommend and your mailbox server is a member of a DAG, you can't use Windows Network load balancing for the CAS part of it. And that's still the same. It's still a blocker. But we never really recommended Windows Network load balancing for Exchange deployments anyway. It is supported, but we typically don't recommend it for a couple reasons. There's scalability concerns. You're not going to be able to scale well beyond, say, seven or eight CAS servers. But more importantly, Windows NLB does not have service awareness. So it doesn't know if an application is actually up or running. If it gets a TCP response, it thinks the service is up. It doesn't know anything about HTTP. So it could send a bunch of your clients to basically a dead door, which is not the experience that you want. It's kind of the opposite of what you'd want a load balancer to do. So we generally don't recommend that. But really, any third-party software load balancer or any third-party virtualized or hardware load balancer will work great for you. In fact, there's some vendors here who've got some excellent Exchange solutions here that are fairly inexpensive as well. All right, so that's it for me. Thanks very much. Hope you enjoy your lunch, and hope to see you again at the sizing episode later. Thanks.